Good afternoon. Good afternoon. My name is Joshua Blank, and I'm the faculty director of the Graduate Tax Program here at NYU. I'd like to welcome you all to the law school, and I hope you've been enjoying the sessions throughout the day. Before we start, on behalf of the Graduate Tax Program, I would like to thank KPMG for sponsoring this lecture series and co-hosting it with us for the last 12 years. We're thrilled to be co-hosting this series. By bringing together so many practitioners, government officials, our own students, academics, this lecture series allows us to think about an important tax topic from both practical and theoretical perspectives. I'd also just like to thank our host of the entire event, Larry Pollack, and give him a special thank you for everything that he's done to make this event happen. I've had the pleasure of working with Larry for the last 3 years on this series, and I've learned that he really loves the NYU KPMG lecture. Every detail, from the panels and speakers to what you just ate for lunch to Jim Grasek on the violin, the comfy chairs behind me, Larry has spent a tremendous amount of time thinking about all of these details, and we're really grateful for all of this effort. It's what really makes the event run so smoothly every year. So thank you for your hard work and dedication. And I'd now like to introduce our keynote speaker, Manal Corwin. We're honored that Manal Corwin is with us today. She is the Deputy Assistant Secretary for International Tax Affairs in the Office of Tax Policy at the U.S. Department of the Treasury. She's responsible for the conduct of legal and economic aspects of tax policy relative to the representation of the United States in bilateral and multilateral relations with other countries. She also advises the legal and economic staffs within the Office of Tax Policy, other offices in the Department of Treasury, and other government agencies. She serves as the U.S. Delegate to the Committee on Fiscal Affairs in the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. Prior to joining the Treasury Department, Ms. Corwin was a principal in the Washington National Tax Office of KPMG from 2001 to 2009. She's a 1991 graduate of Boston University School of Law, where she was a member of the Law Review, and she earned her undergraduate degree from Harvard University in 1986. Please welcome Manal Corwin.
Well, thank you, Joshua. I have to say this is the first tax conference I've been to where there's been a violinist playing, so it's certainly a nice touch. And so I'm a little nervous standing up here because Lee Shepard came up to me right before this and said, please say something interesting so I have something to write about. And I should say, Lee, if you hear me say something interesting, you should check with me afterward to make sure I actually said it. So. Well, good afternoon, everybody. I really appreciate the opportunity to join today's conversation about what I think is a very important and interesting topic. The location and taxation of intangible income is of great consequence to businesses and governments alike, and is one of the central considerations in evaluating options for reforming the international tax rules. I'm hoping I can contribute to today's conversation by shedding some light on why this issue matters to governments, not just the U.S. government, the reason for concern about the current state of affairs, and how this issue influences and informs both the administration's budget proposals and the evaluation of options for international tax reform. So, starting with why does this matter? I think to understand why this matters from a government perspective, we need to start with some foundational principles about our tax system and the tax systems and other tax systems in general. While a lot has been made of the differences between our tax system and those of our trading partners, in fact, these systems are quite similar in certain fundamental ways. First, to start with the obvious, all tax systems share a common, simple objective. The primary purpose of any tax system is to raise the revenue necessary to fund the operation of the government imposing the tax. Government needs sources of revenue to operate effectively, and taxation is the mechanism for realizing that revenue. So the revenue is needed, tax is necessary, and base erosion matters to governments. Second, most tax systems have special rules to deal with income earned outside of their jurisdiction. These international rules are designed with two common objectives: to provide a set of principles establishing primary jurisdiction to tax, that is, rules for determining when a residence country is willing to cede primary taxing jurisdiction over an item of income to another jurisdiction or assert jurisdiction to tax, and to provide a system or mechanism for relieving double taxation where it's appropriate. Finally, and I think this is really a critical point for today's discussion, while certain design features of our international tax rules differ from those of our major trading partners, the foundational policy drivers for the international tax rules in these tax systems are quite similar in very significant ways. How are they similar? Well, first, all of our major trading partners and most OECD countries have, like us, adopted hybrid approaches to international taxation. In other words, none of these jurisdictions have adopted international tax rules that would tax all offshore income currently in all cases, kind of a pure worldwide approach, or rules that would forego tax on all offshore income in all cases, pure territorial systems. Instead, these jurisdictions and we have systems that incorporate policy judgments regarding when it is appropriate or acceptable to cede primary taxing jurisdiction and when it is not. In the case of the US, the decision to cede involves allowing deferral of income. In the case of our trading partners with territorial systems, the decision to cede involves allowing an exemption of income. These two approaches to ceding primary taxing jurisdiction, while involving practical differences in design features, have similar economic impact on the effective rate of tax on the effective tax rate on affected income. Another way in which these tax systems are similar is that in all these hybrid systems, the rules for determining when it is appropriate to cede taxing jurisdiction, that is, by either allowing deferral or exemption, are informed by two common considerations: the level of business activity and the potential for base erosion. Thus, deferral is generally permitted in the case of the US, and an exemption is allowed in the case of the territorial regimes of our trading partners, only with respect to the active business earnings of a controlled foreign corporation. In contrast, passive investment income earned by a controlled foreign corporation is subject to full and immediate taxation and is not eligible for deferral or exemption in most cases. Historically, the policy rationale for ceding taxing rights for active business income was based on a few general assumptions about that income. The first assumption is that the choice of location of active business functions was influenced more by the suitability of the location for conducting those activities. For example, the quality of the labor force, the infrastructure, market conditions, et cetera, than by tax. In other words, there was an appropriate non-tax nexus in most cases to a particular location. A second assumption is that most jurisdictions that offer suitable locations for conducting business activities are not tax havens and have robust tax systems themselves. And a third assumption is that the income generated from the business activity was being taxed in the jurisdiction in which the business activity was taking place. Based on these assumptions, ceding tax jurisdiction seems appropriate, taking into account considerations of competitiveness and as well as practical considerations in providing tax credits or relieving double taxation, and acceptable because of the low risk of base erosion. Under both types of hybrid systems, however, in both the territorial, the hybrid territorial context and in the hybrid worldwide context, this notion of ceding taxing jurisdiction in the context of active income is not absolute. When the assumptions underlying the policy rationale for ceding taxing rights with respect to active business income turns out not to be correct, for example, the active business income is very mobile, or if there is significant potential for base erosion, hybrid systems generally are reluctant to cede primary taxing rights by offering deferral or exemption in every case. And instead, in certain cases, tax such income currently and fully at domestic tax rates. This reluctance to cede taxing jurisdictions under these conditions is acknowledged and accepted in the commentary to the OECD Model Tax Convention. Paragraph 26 of the commentary to Article 1 provides that states that adopt controlled foreign companies provisions or the anti-abuse rules referred to above in their domestic tax laws seek to maintain the equity and neutrality of these laws in an international environment characterized by very different tax burdens. So hybrid systems adopt a number of criteria to identify income with respect to which such equity, neutrality, and concerns about base erosion dictate that they should not cede primary taxing jurisdictions, taxing jurisdiction. These criteria include the degree of mobility of the income, the extent to which income is subject to a low tax rate, and or some combination of those two things, and the nexus of business activity to the location where the income is earned. So for example, under US subpart F rules, foreign-based company sales income is not eligible for a deferral, notwithstanding the fact that such income is generated from an active business because the income is mobile and easily located in a low tax jurisdiction. Similarly, because of the risk of base erosion, a number of exemption systems will not exempt active income offshore in a tax haven or low tax jurisdiction. For example, under the territorial system adopted by Japan, income of a controlled foreign corporation that is subject to an effective rate of tax of 20% or less is not eligible for exemption and is subject to current taxation at the domestic Japanese rate unless the controlled foreign corporation can satisfy certain strict business purpose tests and local activity tests or is doing the majority of its business with unrelated customers. I think in this regard, it's interesting to note that intangible holding companies generally do not qualify unless they satisfy a newly adopted narrow regional headquarters exception. Like Japan, France applies CFC rules and thus potentially denies exemption with respect to certain income subject to an effective rate of tax that is 50% or less of the French domestic effective rate. And similarly, the UK, Germany, and others apply CFC rules based on, in some respects, based on the tax rate to which offshore income is subject. So in sum, all hybrid systems have a gating mechanism that determines when it's appropriate and when they're comfortable ceding tax jurisdiction. The fact that the US uses deferral to cede tax jurisdiction and territorial systems use exemption to cede tax jurisdiction, while not an unimportant design feature and difference, is in many ways far less significant than what is common about the mechanism itself or the fact of having a gate. So how is this overview of International Tax 101 relevant to the topic at hand? Other than I'm in a law school, so I couldn't resist. Really, two reasons. So first, I think these foundational principles are common threads among tax systems that are most relevant to us among our trading partners, I think shed light on the extent to which governments should and do have concern about the location and taxation of intangibles in a global economy. Second, these foundational principles and common threads explain the policy driving current US proposals and inform the administration's approach to international tax reform. So turning to the first question, in light of these foundational principles, are there good reasons for governments, and in particular the US government, to be concerned about the location and taxation of intangible income? The evidence suggests that the answer to this question is a resounding yes. There have been many studies, and I'm sure many of you have read the literature out there over the past few years, that look at the location of income relative to business activity. These studies, which are typically based on data from the US Bureau of Economic Analysis, surveys of US direct investment abroad, show that while surrogate measures of real economic activity, such as employment, location of productive assets, and customer sales, are located in jurisdictions with large economies and big markets, like the UK, Mexico, and Germany, profits are earned in jurisdictions lacking such economic characteristics, but having very low effective tax rates. For example, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Ireland, and others. To take just one example, a recent study compares the top 10 locations of US multinational firm affiliate employment in 2008 with the top 10 locations of US multinational firm affiliate gross profits. There was virtually no overlap in the 10 countries. And while the effective tax rates for the first group of countries were not particularly low, the effective tax rates associated with the second group of countries was extraordinarily low. In a similar vein, numerous studies have attempted to statistically examine the relationship between profitability and tax rates using company-level data. In general, these studies find a statistically significant inverse relationship between pre-tax profitability and tax rates. That is, pre-tax profit margins tend to be high in low-tax jurisdictions and low in high-tax jurisdictions. Finally, with respect to intangible income in particular, data from the Bureau of Economic Analysis benchmark surveys of U.S. investment abroad in 1994, 1999, and 2004 suggest that low-tax countries are becoming much more important destinations of U.S.-produced intangible assets. For example, the share of total affiliate royalties accounted for by Ireland and Singapore doubled between 1994 and 1999 and has further increased through 2004, which is the last available data this particular study has. What this evidence illustrates is that intangible income is highly mobile, it is being shifted to very low tax jurisdictions, and is being separated from the location of the business activity that generates the income, at least the kind of business activity that underlies the assumptions that have been the foundation for decisions about when it's appropriate to cede taxing rights. The implication of all of this from a policy perspective is that governments should be concerned because this kind of income has many of the hallmarks of the kind of income that about which hybrid tax systems are have traditionally been concerned, and with respect to which hybrid tax systems historically have been reluctant to cede primary taxing jurisdiction. So having established a reason for concern, the question then becomes, what should governments do to address concerns about that taxation of intangible income? I think the best way to answer this question is to understand the objectives of current rules and the limitation of current rules in fulfilling these objectives with respect to intangible income. I've already talked about the objectives of current rules in the context of our tax system and in the context of hybrid territorial tax systems of our major trading partners, and concluded that the current taxation of intangible income is potentially at odds with some of those objectives in terms of the decision of when to cede taxing rights. So what are the limitations of current law? As noted earlier, hybrid tax systems adopt a number of criteria to identify income with respect to which they should not cede primary taxing jurisdiction because the income is mobile. In the case of the United States, the criteria under current subpart F rules, which are principally activity-based and not focused on the level of foreign tax or on establishing a nexus between the location of the income and the location of the business activity, our current rules are not sufficiently robust to adequately address current concerns about intangible income shifting. The excess return proposal in the administration's fiscal 2013 budget seeks to fill the gap by adding additional criteria, including a mobility test, so the tie to intangible income, which is inherently mobile, a tax rate test, which is a risk factor on which other hybrid tax systems rely, and a quantitative test, the excess return calculation, which attempts to serve as a proxy for establishing nexus between the location of the income and the location of the activity. Thus, the administration's fiscal 2013 budget proposes to expand subpart F to include excess income from transactions involving intangibles transferred to low tax affiliates. Specifically, where there's a transaction, including a sale, lease, or license, or the provision of a service that uses or incorporates a transferred intangible, and the income from the intangible is subject to a low effective tax rate, which for purposes of the proposal is below 15%, though there's a sliding scale between 10 and 15, then the excess income from the transaction will be treated as subpart F income and not eligible for deferral. In other words, the proposal would say that in those cases, the U.S. is choosing not to cede primary taxing jurisdiction over that income. For this purpose, excess income would be defined as the excess of gross income from a covered transaction over 150% of the costs, excluding interests and taxes, that are properly allocated and apportioned to this income. The 150% measure is what was used to estimate the proposal, and the mechanisms in there are really levers that could subject to further consideration. But the principle is the same, that there's a tax lever and there's an excess returns lever. So some have suggested that the concerns about the shifting of intangible income is fundamentally a concern about the abuse of transfer pricing rules, and thus should be addressed only to the extent that there is a transfer pricing problem. We do not completely agree. To be sure, transfer pricing abuses and complexity exacerbate the problem of income shifting with respect to intangible income and with respect to any mobile income. As I talked about earlier, however, the U.S. tax system, as well as the hybrid territorial systems adopted by many of our major trading partners, historically have been concerned about mobile income and the potential for base erosion, even in the absence of transfer pricing concerns or a specific transfer pricing abuse. Thus, under subpart F rules, the denial of deferral for foreign-based company income applies without regard to the existence or suspicion of a transfer pricing abuse. Similarly, under the CFC rules or regimes of many of our major trading partners, the denial of an exemption for certain categories of income based on the effective tax rate to which the income is subject applies without regard to transfer pricing concerns. Do these CFC regimes and the decision to not cede taxing rights serve as a backstop to transfer pricing? Sure, and subpart F has often been referred to as a backstop to transfer pricing concerns. They do. But that is a collateral benefit of these regimes, not the primary purpose. So the administration's excess return proposal is consistent with this historical approach and reflects a concern about intangible profit shifting for the reasons identified before, even in the context of perfect transfer pricing. That said, it does not mean that there isn't work to be done in the transfer pricing area. We need to carefully and continually examine our rules to make sure that they effectively implement the arm's length standard and to identify weaknesses that are susceptible to exploitation. In addition, I think it's important for us to continue the work that we do with the OECD, with other countries, regarding the issues surrounding the location and taxation of intangibles. While in general the OECD does not address base erosion and anti-avoidance measures because they are viewed as the province of domestic legislation, its work is clearly concerned with the connection between economic activity and income. For example, in the business restructuring project that's now Chapter 9 of the OECD transfer pricing guidelines, important safeguards relating to the control and the capacity to bear risk, to control and capacity to bear risk, are incorporated into the evaluation of contractual allocations of risk within a multinational. In addition, in the current intangibles project, the OECD is seeking to look beyond labels, such as accounting goodwill, to ensure that transfers of intangibles are remunerated at full value, reflecting the economic contributions and realistic alternatives of the transferor. So with this context, I want to turn just briefly to talk about how this issue and this topic informs our discussion and consideration of international tax reform. The location and taxation of intangibles is a significant consideration in evaluating the options that we are considering for reforming our international tax rules. On February 22nd, the Treasury Department released the President's framework for reforming the U.S. business tax system. The report articulated the administration's concern that current international provisions of the code provide opportunities and incentives to shift profits offshore in a manner that significantly erodes the U.S. tax base and emphasizes the need for business tax reform to address this concern. Consistent with the approach taken in the overall framework that the President put out, however, the report opts not to articulate a detailed and specific proposal for reforming the international tax code. Rather, the report notes that international reform should focus on maximizing investment, growth, and jobs in the United States, and balance the need to reduce tax incentives to locate profit and jobs overseas with the need for U.S. companies to be able to compete overseas. To this end, the report articulated two general principles in relation to strengthening our international tax rules that should be incorporated in and guide the development of any specific international reform plan. The first of these two principles articulated is that a pure territorial system would aggravate rather than ameliorate many of the problems under current rules and therefore should be rejected. All of our major trading partners have reached a similar conclusion, and none of them have adopted pure territorial systems. So going back, they've all created a line that's a gating issue as to when to allow exemption to apply and when to have full inclusion apply. The second principle is that certain offshore earnings should be subject to a minimum rate of tax that is designed in a way that balances the need to stop rewarding tax havens and prevent the race to the bottom, with the goal of keeping U.S. companies on a level playing field with competitors when engaged in certain local country activity. Both of these principles are important in addressing concerns regarding the location and taxation of intangible income. The first principle, rejection of pure territoriality, affirms that, like our trading partners, we do not believe it is appropriate to cede taxing jurisdiction with respect to all offshore income. The second principle improves on current rules and introduces an additional tool for addressing concerns about the location and taxation of intangible income. Our current hybrid worldwide system does not incorporate this principle, and as a result, creates a strong incentive to shift profit, including intangible profit, to very low tax jurisdictions and defer the profit indefinitely. In contrast, as discussed earlier, many of our trading partners, like Japan, for example, have already incorporated a principle of a minimum tax in the context of their own hybrid systems by requiring full inclusion and denying exemption for certain foreign income that's not subject to a minimum effective rate of tax. This feature of a hybrid territorial system is more effective in addressing concerns about intangible income shifting in many ways than our current rules. Accordingly, in order to strengthen our international system relative to today, the President's framework for reform calls for the principle of a minimum tax on foreign earnings to be included in consideration of any of the possible options for reforming the international tax system. And that concept can be included in a number of different ways, in a number of different variations on international tax reform. There isn't one approach to adopting that, and I think talking about how territorial systems have done it is a good example of that. So by focusing on these key principles and common features of effective international tax systems, the administration's framework is intended to start the discussion about international tax reform by establishing common ground regarding principles and priorities first, and then turning to the elements of design second, hopefully with the collective input of lawmakers and stakeholders. So in summary, this conference, I think, is very aptly named. The taxation of intangible income is indeed a moving target in a global economy. Given the dollars involved, the location and taxation of intangibles is of significant concern to governments and businesses alike. The data suggests that there's really good reason for concern about the link between intangible income shifting and base erosion. While transfer pricing abuses are relevant, they are not the only consideration for governments with respect to this issue. Intangible income, even when generated from active business activities or active businesses, even when is accurately priced, has all the hallmarks of the kind of income with respect to which hybrid tax systems, both worldwide and territorial, have been reluctant to cede jurisdiction because of concerns about base erosion. That's why both hybrid and, hybrid worldwide and hybrid territorial systems have adopted CFC rules that establish criteria such as activity tests, mobility, and minimum tax rates for identifying this kind of income and subjecting it to full and current taxation. In the context of the current worldwide system that we have, our subpart F rules, while identifying certain kinds of mobile business income as income of concern, are not robust enough to address current concerns about intangible income shifting. The administration's FY 2013 budget proposal thus proposes a targeted expansion of subpart F that focuses on key risk factors, the mobility of the income, the tax rate, and the nexus of activity, the location of the activity and the location of the income. Other approaches might also be effective. As I said, the administration in its budget proposal took a very targeted and approach and therefore has a lot of levers in there. Broader brush approaches are also possible. In the context of broader international tax reform, I think the administration's framework for reform has focused on the two key principles that we identified, the notion that it's important to have a gating principle like our trading partners have, therefore the rejection of any pure territorial approach. In addition to this concept of a minimum tax as a way to affect concerns about mobile income and base erosion. I think because these principles can be incorporated, as I said, into a range of specific reform options, gaining comfort that these principles and the policy concerns that they are intended to address are secured will establish common ground and allow greater flexibility in considering various design options for reform. I think in this regard, we look forward to continued engagement with lawmakers and stakeholders about these important issues. And I thank you for your time and attention this afternoon.
Thank you, Manal. You can actually take one of the seats here at the debate of your.
I don't need this for that.
No, you do.
You can sit at the end because we'll have the government together. Thank you. One of these two. Either one.
Where's the mic? He's got them all.
You want to sit next to Manal? So Manal, thank you very much for your keynote speech and perspectives from the Treasury Department concerning the concerns of the government with respect to the mobility of intangibles and the income that flows from that. The next session is quite a lively session. We call it a proposition for debate, where the pros and cons of the excess returns legislative proposal will be debated. This session is somewhat audience interactive, as 150 of you have electronic handheld polling devices where you'll be able to respond to some polling questions that will be asked after the debate. The debate session will be moderated by Willard Taylor. Willard was a partner with Sullivan and Cromwell for 35 years and remains of counsel to the firm. Willard is a former chairman of the tax section of the New York State Bar Association and is an adjunct professor at NYU Law School's Tax LLM program. Willard will now introduce the distinguished members of the debate session. Willard.
Thank you, Larry, that's great. Well, first let me introduce two of the speakers here who have not been introduced before. Manal, of course, you know about. Tom Zollo was on this morning, so you're familiar with his background as well. Dan Shaviro, by the way, I'm looking at you guys. Shaviro, excuse me, looking at this way, I think we've got the wrong people on the right and the wrong people on the left. But anyway, Dan is right there. And Dan is a professor of taxation at NYU Law School, who went to Yale Law School for his legal education, was in private practice, and also worked on the Joint Committee. He's been teaching for a number of years at Chicago and at NYU. He's written extensively with respect to this subject and is now in the process of writing a book, Fixing the U.S. International Tax Rules. And the second person so far unintroduced is Marc Levey, who probably many of you know from practice. Marc is a partner at Baker and McKenzie. Before that, he was, among other things, at the Justice Department in the Tax Division and also at the Internal Revenue Service. He's got extensive experience in litigating transfer pricing and other tax disputes. Now, the way in which we're going to do this, I'm going to say a couple of words about the subject and the materials, is basically go back and forth. It's meant to be interactive, but fundamentally, each of the participants is going to have 6 or 7 minutes. We're going to dock Tom Zollo, because he already took up a couple of minutes by anticipating the debate, but go back and forth with points of view. The proposal, if you look in your book, the Green Book explanation of what the proposal is there, which Manal referred to. The Joint Committee explanation of substantially the same proposal in 2012 is there. So you have those materials in front of you. A couple of comments I would make. One, as a revenue matter, if you look at the international proposals of the administration, the big revenue raisers are in the foreign tax credit area. But once you're away from that, this is the biggest revenue raiser that they propose, the excess return proposal. Another point to which just underscores, I think, something Manal said, is that everybody who so far jumped into the fray seems to believe there's a serious problem here. I mean, the Camp bill, which is a bill, after all, that would have an exemption system, includes as one option putting the excess return provision in for royalties. It has other options, but there it is, and I believe the NZ bill, which is the only other territorial bill we have now, also has that. If you want to go further before we get into the debate, there is some statutory language both in the Camp bill and some that was released by the Treasury. Okay, that said, I mean, Manal, you did a great job in presenting this as responsive to a factually based concern about what was going on in the world and a response that is seemingly consistent with what our trading partners do and what our present tax system is. And Tom, you want to weigh in and say something about that?
I will weigh in. And, you know, I did try to condition the audience this morning to my way of thinking, but after listening to Manal talk about the issue and the proposal, I was almost so persuaded that I, you know, was going to give up the debate here. And I will say I was almost persuaded, Manal. And certainly Manal made a persuasive case for why the United States has to protect its tax base and prevent the shifting of income from intangible property. However, the proposal in question is not the way to go about it. And I'll suggest that even the title of the proposal is misleading, talking about excess returns from intangible property. It makes it sound as if this is a surrogate for transfer pricing. First of all, excess returns. That's a normative phrase that implies that somehow somebody's getting returns that are above those that are appropriate. And then from intangible property implies that those excess returns are somehow related to intangible property that came from the United States. And I'll suggest that when you think about how this provision would actually be applied, it has nothing to do with transfer pricing principles, and it has very little to do with the transfer of intangibles outside the United States. First, you know, why does it have nothing to do with transfer pricing? Well, it has nothing to do with transfer pricing because there's absolutely no requirement that the IRS or anyone else demonstrate that these excess returns were caused by or are related to the intangible property. All you have to show is that the CFC received some intangible property from the United States. Now, the CFC may have developed the intangible property itself. It may have purchased the intangible property from a third party that's really driving the profits, or it could just be lucky. It could be benefiting from temporary imbalances in the markets. Also, in the excess definition that Manal described, it's based upon an arbitrary return over costs. It may be that the foreign CFC, which may have fully participated in cost sharing for a number of years, is earning returns that are not out of line with what the US is earning on its own investment in intangible property. So there's nothing in the formula that requires that the CFC have unusual profitability in a given year relative to what the group overall is earning, which of course would be the case if you were applying formulary apportionment as an alternative. Second, as I mentioned this morning, the requirement that the CFC has received or benefited from IP received from the US parent is really a non-requirement requirement because a CFC almost always will have received some intangible property from its parent. It may be branding goods under the parent's trade name using its trademarks. It may be benefiting from contracts that were negotiated in the United States. However, it may be that the profits in question are actually generated by IP that was funded by the CFC out of its own personnel. I'll also say that there's this notion, and you know, the case that is put forward as the principal case is one where the foreign entity is a cash box and all the clever people who've invented the IP sit in the United States. More and more the companies that I go to, the majority of their technical workforce is not in the United States. And I would submit that people are coming up with clever ideas in Ireland, in Germany, in India, in China. And if the place of origination is to be the hallmark here, the United States has a very weak claim to taxing profits that have been appropriately cost-shared. And then the final point that I'll make is setting a low tax threshold at 15% will simply encourage taxpayers to find a way to get the income taxed at 15% or more. And maybe we're going to go a long way in helping Ireland with its fiscal problems because, you know, the first thing that Ireland might propose is to raise the tax rate to 15.1%. I'll note that several years ago when Japan instituted a similar provision with a 25% tax rate, the Netherlands adopted a 25.5% tax rate, and Micronesia, not to be outdone, had a 25.01% tax rate. So even if the U.S. corporate rate were to go, for example, to 28%, if you could get a 15% rate and achieve deferral, you'd definitely go for it. As I indicated this morning, people are arbitraging out of Ireland, even though its rate is 12.5%, and out of Switzerland, where they might have an 8 to 10% rate. So in conclusion...
Sorry, Tom, I was just going to ask you, I hope maybe you're going to get to it in your conclusion. So are you for what, formulary apportionment instead?
Or,
sorry. Manal knows the answer to that.
No? Okay, well, maybe you'll...
I thought we were just...
You left us hanging this morning on your slide in which you said all the things that were wrong and then not the right way to do it, but what is the right way to do it?
I'm just going to say that this is not the right way to do it. There are several alternatives that I think would make more sense. And you know, sitting here in New York, I'm reminded of what the problem is, and I'm going to draw something from one of the gubernatorial candidates the last time around, Jimmy McMillan, and paraphrase him, and I'll say the problem is the tax rate is too damn high.
Dan?
Okay, well, I think Tom has established a benchmark that you're very rude unless you say that the prior person almost persuaded you. So I'm going to have to, rather than seem graceless and rude, I'm going to have to say the same thing, that Tom almost persuaded me. But the ultimate lack of persuasion, I think, had a lot to do with the sort of notion of transfer pricing being the benchmark that we'd use to decide whether something is a good proposal or not. We have a transfer pricing system now. It's true that we could try to do a little better job that have more enforcement, but there's some basic conceptual problems with it, such as trying to find comparables in worlds when being a multinational is different from dealing with separate companies, and when particular industries don't really have arm's length. They're really all internationally integrated. I don't think transfer pricing can do the job, and that something varies from transfer pricing is no criticism of it. Now, the Treasury proposal certainly is not perfect, and I'll say a thing or two about that, including one thing I really do agree with Tom about. But we know we have a big problem here with income shifting. We know that U.S. firms that have a lot of people in the U.S. doing things and they're based in IP are playing staggeringly low U.S. and worldwide tax rates. We know things like, for example, that in the Cayman Islands, I mean, we hear the suggestion that, well, the affiliates abroad are actually doing this stuff. I think it was the U.S. or global multinationals are earning 9 times the amount in the Caymans of Cayman's actual GDP. The first time I heard that, I thought, gee, the local Cayman's firms must be losing a heck of a lot of money. Obviously, that's not really what's happening. So we know that income is being shifted out, and the important distinction, out of the U.S. and out of other countries into tax havens, and that's a problem we should worry about. Why should we worry about it? Well, I'll talk in a moment about what happens if U.S. companies are avoiding foreign taxes, which I actually am sympathetic to. You have very rich individuals who have become wealthy through startups. You think of Zuckerberg or something like that. They're not being taxed much at the individual level in many cases. And the corporate tax is really the backup. It's the backstop. The reason for the corporate tax is, to some extent, to proxy for the individual tax. For example, Steve Jobs paid himself $1 a year, but he was getting very wealthy. If Apple had been taxed at a high effective rate, that really would have been just as good as taxing Steve Jobs in a way. But we're not accomplishing that when the U.S. companies that we really need to tax the company to tax the founders indirectly manage to shift all their income to tax havens. There are also clear efficiency problems when there's economic activity in the U.S. and the shiftable stuff is taxed at a low rate and the other stuff is taxed at a higher rate. So I think there are some, and I don't think that the U.S., Tom's last point, really wants to go to a system that's competitive with the Cayman Islands. That's not really going to work for us. So we have a problem. We know transfer pricing isn't and won't do anything about it. And the question is, what can we do? And I think the Treasury proposal, which Manal didn't say it has to be this proposal, is in the ballpark of trying to do something about this problem. And so as a result, it's worth considering. Now, an important question would be, are the U.S. firms that would be hit by this rule, are they really avoiding U.S. taxes or are they avoiding foreign taxes? And I think in a lot of the time, what they're going to be doing is they're going to be avoiding U.S. taxes. You have U.S. Luckily or unluckily, U.S. corporate residence is still a decent proxy, not by any means a perfect one, for firms that really the people who do the work are, a lot of them are in the U.S., the ones with the ideas, the ones who do the startups. And if you see income of a U.S. company arising in Germany, there's some chance that it really arose there. If you see it rising in the Caymans, you kind of know it didn't really arise there, and it could have been shifted either from the U.S. and from Germany. And the paradox here is that I would say that because the difference between U.S. taxes and foreign taxes, if it's U.S. taxes, we got the money. So I actually think it's good for the U.S. if U.S. companies shift taxable income from Germany to the Caymans and avoid German tax, which we don't get the money. But I think, in fact, empirically, what's happening in a lot of the cases that the Treasury proposal would try to address is that it's U.S. taxes that are being avoided in terms of where the activity really occurred and where the income really arose. So I think that it's an imperfect filter. One thing I was reminded of as well when Tom talked about excess returns, and I agree with him, excess returns is not a perfect measure, but it's a proxy. When you see income arising in a tax haven, you kind of know it very likely didn't arise there. And so something I thought of is the Israelis had trouble taxing restaurants on their income, so they came up with a tablecloth tax. They taxed you on the number of tablecloths that you had to put through the laundry, because that was kind of a proxy for the number of tables. They didn't want to encourage Israeli restaurants to have dirtier tables by not changing their tablecloths all the time. I guess I don't know what they did about the paper tablecloth problem, but it was a proxy for something else. They had nothing against a restaurant using lots of tablecloths, but they're trying to measure something else, namely that they had a lot of business and a lot of customers. Likewise here, the excess returns is really a proxy for something else. If you see excess returns in the Caymans, you kind of suspect that that income didn't arise in the Caymans. Well, in a low-tax country generally, because the low-tax countries, despite Ireland and Switzerland are not perfect examples, they tend to be taxed, or many of them are tax havens in which not a lot of activity occurs. So I think that the proposal is in the ballpark of addressing a real problem. I personally feel that from a certain perspective, the U.S. would treat foreign taxes no differently than any other costs. We want a U.S. company to spend a dollar to avoid a dollar of foreign taxes because we don't get the money. But when you kind of paradoxically interacting with that is the fact that when you see money in tax havens, you know it wasn't really earned there most likely, and that it may very well have come from the U.S. And of course, the nature of the problem is that you're not sure if it came from the U.S. or elsewhere, but there'll be a very good suspicion that a lot of it comes from the U.S. Now, I think the biggest concern I have, the two biggest concerns I have with the proposal are the following. One is, obviously, this is only going to affect U.S. resident firms. So if you have U.S. people doing stuff through foreign, they decide to incorporate abroad, any residence-based worldwide tax proposal misses them. I've kind of studied and written about it recently, and my sense is that for now that's not a big enough problem to constrain us beyond a certain point. So I think that you can, to an extent still today, it's something to worry about in the future. You have taxes on U.S. resident firms, so people just incorporate abroad. It seems that U.S. incorporation is still good enough proxy for what we care about, which is really U.S. individuals doing things in the U.S. The thing I worry about the most is really the point Tom made, and here I was persuaded, except I guess I'd been persuaded in advance, that it's very dangerous. Minimum tax idea, for a good reason, the quote, minimum tax concept is not a very popular one. And it's really because of the discontinuity. Again, the lower the tax rate that income is of the country where income was ostensibly earned, the greater your suspicion, not knowledge, but suspicion that the income might not have really been earned there. But if you have something that like disappears at 15%, you get exactly the problem that Tom said, which is that instead of paying 5% abroad and then getting hit by us, they pay 15% abroad. The U.S. gains absolutely nothing. I think that's a design question that's within the realm of what Manal said is still flexible. So I think I can still, in good faith, even no matter how badly I feel about that problem, urge you to click your little clickers to vote for the proposal. But I think it is,
it will
be important to design it so that you don't have something like you pay one more percentage of tax and bingo, you avoid a lot of U.S. taxes. That would be a bad way of designing it, but I think that can still be addressed.
So,
go ahead.
Lee Shepard, Dan has set Manal up to change the administration's proposal on the fly, so that might be your interesting news.
I don't have a whole lot of inside information about that.
Mark, are you now persuaded?
Well, he's almost. Tell me you're almost persuaded, please.
I'm going to be the protagonist. Tom persuaded me, and I'm not going to repeat the things that Tom stated because I tend to agree with them. And I am not favorably disposed for this policy because I don't believe a policy should put just a patch over provisions that they don't believe are working. And I've been around enough to see proposals based on Treasury projections, and I'm concerned about the Treasury projections because there's a problem. Is there a big problem? Is there an incurable problem? I don't see that. I see a couple things here that bother me. Number one, you talk about reform. And I thought, Manal, it was very interesting that you mentioned the French rules, the French rule 209B, but you didn't state the complete rule. And I think that's very relevant. The French 209B rule says if the effective tax rate is less than 10% of the rate that's in France, then all that income becomes attributable to France unless there is the active conduct of a trade or business in that jurisdiction. And that, to me, is a very, very important point because when you look to conceptually the underpinning of what's really taking place here, is it's almost like the investor model in the cost-sharing regs. They're saying, if you're in a low-tax jurisdiction, we're deeming you not to have economic substance, and we're gonna pay, let you earn a certain cost-plus return, just like the investor model says in the cost-sharing regs, because they're presuming there's no economic substance. And that's not the way the French rule works, and that's not how most rules work when there's an active conduct of a trade or business. And that's not necessarily the way the subpart F income rules work when you have the active conduct of a trade or business in a particular jurisdiction. So the classic example, and I think Tom started to allude to it, is if I'm a distributor of a U.S. company, and by the way, your numbers get slanted because I think you forget most U.S. multinationals earn more money globally than they do in the United States, so that does tend to distort things. But if I'm a distributor in a foreign jurisdiction X, and the tax rate happens to be 12%, and I say to my distributor, you're going to be my super distributor, and I'm giving you the rights to the trademark, but I want you to enhance that value of the trademark and develop it into the local jurisdiction. So you become the developer and owner of that economic right, that marketing intangible. And if that distributor in that jurisdiction that's 12% happens to be quite successful, it will have excess profits just by your definition. And you're going to be attributing all of that profit back to the United States under this provision because the marketing intangible or the intangible that's being invested in and developed by that affiliate will be connected to the trademark that was provided by the U.S. company. Now,
Marc, can I ask you a question? We are entitled to interrupt each other. Somebody else can jump in. But are you disputing the statistical problem that Manal raised in the beginning?
I'm raising a question about the statistical problem because I've seen it so many times in the past. But in my example,
I'm sorry, what have you seen so many times?
I've seen so many times in the past when there's been tax legislation where the statistics that they use for revenue-producing provisions that are in the...
We're talking about the disproportion that Dan also referred to between location of what are called normal economic factors like employment, physical plant, and the income.
Ed Kleinbart had a good line once. He noted, probably more than once, in fact, knowing Ed a lot more than once, but he noted that U.S. companies, their Irish affiliates, have amazingly high rates of return. He said it can't just be the luck of the Irish. Maybe in one case it was.
Well, going back to my example, and I'm not talking about the luck of the Irish, but I'm talking about a distributor that's made the investment. And a basic tenet in tax law is that you try to match the income with the expense that created it. And in this instance, while the investment that created that income becomes irrelevant because if it goes over that threshold, it gets pulled back into the United States. And that, to me, doesn't make sense. So one of the issues that's raised in the committee report is this distinction of when you have these rules defining excess profit, you're really disregarding the fact that there may be a significant investment producing that income or that intangible in that local jurisdiction. Now, let's just assume it's the Cayman Islands, and let's just assume that there is no one down there. You don't need these rules to attack the Cayman Islands under economic substance. That is there. You codified economic substance. Sam Maruka and his transfer pricing group is looking for these kinds of cases, the bad cases that can really become revenue producers instead of going after taxpayers that are compliant, because those are the cases we all acknowledge are problematic cases where income is being seeped out of the United States. I don't pay a whole heck of a lot of attention, to the sound bites that exist with Google and with GE and all these other companies that have gone and negotiated deals with foreign governments, including the United States. If they cut a bad deal, they cut a bad deal. I'm talking about the abusive types of cases that go on. I would suspect that there's not as many abusive cases as you've seen, but there are a number of cases that there's money seepage that through normal transfer pricing audits, if they're done appropriately and through...
Well, there's statistical disparities, though, between profit rates and different jurisdictions.
What did you think of the, Marc, and it's a bit unfair because I don't think you were here first thing in the morning, but...
No, I slept late today.
The Joint Committee study of Alpha, Bravo, Delta, Echo, Foxtrot, they all seem to be cases in which there was a problem.
Let me address it, because I think it was part of my earlier presentation. And I think Mark's quite right about, you know, if it's not naughty income, you know, if the local affiliate has made an investment and is earning returns, you know, God bless them. What seems to disturb Dan is the strip into no-tax jurisdictions, like the Cayman Islands. You know, I would suggest that it's very easy to deal with that. You could get rid of check the box on tax haven entities, and you could get rid of 954C6 that allows CFC to CFC stripping. Problem over. But if an Irish affiliate or a Swiss affiliate has, through a long period, made an investment and borne the risk of IP development, and it happens to be successful, it should, as part of that bargain, earn the returns. Otherwise, it's so head we win, you know, tails you lose. Right?
Well, let me step,
yeah, and that's precisely my point, by the way, Manal.
I'm not worried about them too much at 5% worldwide tax, but go ahead.
Yeah, well, I'll be less polite and say I'm completely not persuaded by either of you two.
I guess we're not surprised.
But just a couple of things to explain.
I mean, it'd be terrible if he went back to Washington and said, you're dropping the proposal.
Yeah, no, that we made a huge mistake. So a couple of things. Maybe I'll start with Tom and then go to some of the other statements that were made. I think the one thing I do completely agree with you about is that this is not a transfer pricing proposal, and that's what I said in my speech. It wasn't intended to be a transfer pricing proposal, so evaluating it and judging it based on whether the mathematics of the excess return calculation accurately capture, you know, the excess income that shouldn't be there and should be the U.S. is completely the wrong way to go about it from our perspective, because that is not the reason we designed it that way. I think the reason it was designed that way is to, in the first instance, before we get to the design, address a concern that we had that I think is well established in the literature, and not just based on assumptions that the government has made. And I think it's sort of a false, I don't know, what you call it, but you know, to argue that because in the past the government has built policies on false assumptions or not accurate assumptions, therefore the data must be inaccurate here. I don't see how that quite fits together. I think the data regarding the amount of profit that has been moving into locations and the rates of returns in low tax jurisdictions relative to the rates of returns in high tax jurisdictions on the same kind of activity income are fairly well established and demonstrate that we have a concern. So the proposal was intended to say, look, we have this issue of income is being shifted, and we know the income is being shifted, and the fact is the income isn't always being shifted in the place to where the activity takes place. And it, like other subpart F income, it is not the case that just because there's an active business, there is no subpart F income. I referenced the foreign-based company sales rule as an example of that. Nobody questions whether that activity is active business activity, but those rules were intended to say we have a concern, and the concern there related to the separation of the manufacturing activity and the sales, and the income ends up somewhere else. Very, very similar here. We're having, and I think it is Ed Kleinbard who, you know, coined the stateless income problem, where you have the country in which the sales or the activities taking place, and you have the residence country, and then there's this third company where the income shows up. That's the concern. Lots of ways to have gone about it. Why did we go about it this way? And you know, maybe the title does lend itself to transfer pricing tags. I think, as I said before, the idea is all of our rules that have been geared towards, and rules of other countries, that have been geared towards trying to deal with income that there is a concern that is mobile and susceptible to base erosion, are surrogates. They are risk-based approaches to identifying this kind of income, and they are risk-based approaches to determining maybe we shouldn't see taxing jurisdiction. If we do, we will have significant base erosion. Tax rate tests are used that way, and the French rule, I think maybe we're talking about different French rules. The activity tests are often part of these tax rate tests. The question is, what is an active conduct of a trader business, and to what extent is it tied in the jurisdiction where the income is being earned? But in any case,
that is the 209B test.
Right, but there's a tie to the place, and then there's qualitative differences, and the standard is a 50% standard. But anyway, I'm not going to quibble about foreign law. I think the bottom line is that we had tried to identify the risk factors that are typical to tag this income, one being tax rate, one being intangibles because of its mobility and the fact that it's tied to intangibles, and excess returns, again, was a surrogate for tying the determining to what extent there is a tie to the costs and the return that you're earning on those costs. Without trying to be precise in terms of calculating a transfer price, but looking at a quantitative number that raises a risk, a flag for us, that maybe with above a certain amount, we shouldn't necessarily cede jurisdiction. Underlying that premise is the notion that we do accept that there are cases where we ought to cede jurisdiction. And you know what? And we do. In the case, that's why we allow a deferral right now under our rules. And so it was trying to, with respect to this kind of income, be very targeted. No question we could have gone more broad-based. In fact, in the prior versions of this proposal, we did go more broadly. And the proposal there was focused not on a transactional basis. The excess, to the extent there was a transfer of intangible, the excess was based on a return on all the assets of the CFC, not the particular excess with respect to the transaction that involved the intangible. A lot of feedback came back and concerns and criticisms that was overbroad, and a lot of the issues about, well, what about self-developed intangibles? What about the fact that you're capturing income that has nothing to do with intangible profit? That was overbroad given the kinds of concerns and the kind of income. So we went more targeted. Other jurisdictions go even more broad. They say tax rate test is it. We could have said if it's at this tax rate or below, all the income is currently taxed, all subpart F income, current inclusion, and not tried to slice and dice and figure out what's the excess piece and so forth. So I think the fact that we have those, again, were intended to be surrogates for trying to identify the income of concern and maybe the income that we can be less concerned about, without necessarily therefore meaning it's bad income or income that was abusively put there. And then just one last point about the tax rate test. Anytime you have a tax rate test, there's always going to be that issue of, is there a cliff effect or not? The proposal has been was intended to deal with a little bit by adding a range, so there's some smoothing, but even no matter how much smoothing you do, there is that risk. I think in the context of our proposal, it's less of a risk because the income that is exposed here is just this income that's calculated as an excess. What that means is if someone wants to deliberately avoid this by subjecting themselves to a higher rate of tax, they're exposing all of their income to that higher rate of tax. So the cost is much more significant in terms of trying to plan into a higher tax within the foreign jurisdiction. And then the other point is tax rates is obviously our corporate tax rate has an impact on that, and that in the context of reform we've already said we recognize our corporate tax rate is high, and that within the administration's reform plan.
Manal, can I ask a question? Was there any thought given in determining excess returns to thinking about multi-year averaging? Because I'll just make the observation that the incurrence of R&D or investment in IP rarely is in the same period that you see the returns. And one of my objections to this, as I mentioned, is that in a particular year, a particular CFC may enjoy returns that, for example, were funded in prior periods. Yeah. And this seems to be a very rough approach.
And there are analogies like earnings stripping, for example.
So it seems to me you could go with worldwide taxation. You could go with something narrower, like my suggestion about eliminating check the box and CFC stripping. But that this is kind of like running for mayor saying you're going to stop crime. And the way you're going to stop crime is throw everybody in jail the day after you're elected. Well, we'll certainly stop crime, but you're going to have a lot of innocent people occupying the cells. Yeah. And it strikes me that this is too formulaic.
Well, again, I mean, I think it is a surrogate. I think that the design features of that surrogate and how we go about it, I think, are open to discussion. And a multi-year averaging is something that certainly is worth considering as a way to smooth the consideration. But I think, the false premise is this notion that it's criminal to have fallen within this proposal, as opposed to it is a decision that governments are making that they make all the time and that we make all the time because of a concern about the kind of income, and that's the line we drew.
Maybe not criminal, but you do think it's naughty.
I think I cut Marc off before you had a chance to make your reach your conclusion. Do you want to say something?
Everybody's kind of jumped in, and the thought that keeps sticking in my mind here is This is tax reform. And we're dealing with the system right now and I'll go back to transfer pricing because, I mean, it's hard to distinguish that there isn't a transfer pricing component here. And that we have a problem in that I don't believe the Internal Revenue Service really knows how to manage the whole process. It's become entirely too complex. I have met very few internal international examiners who even understand the cost-sharing rules. And I find that there's way too much emphasis on the comparables and the economic analysis. When I look at this proposal, all I can see is double tax. I see controversies over what is excess profit. Are we going to have Internal Revenue Service agents having to conduct an audit as to what is the effect of foreign tax rate?
Where do you see the double tax any more than any other kind of subpart?
The example that I just gave you before, where you have the distributor that's investing in developing its own intangible, even though it's affixed to the trademark, and they get a higher return.
How is it any different than any other subpart F income? We provide a foreign tax credit. It's not income. We're not going to provide a foreign tax credit.
You're bringing two completely different systems, and you're having a system which is, in effect, vitiating the arm's length principle. So that how are you going to be able to have one common ground to be able to have competent authorities negotiate a resolution unless it's Middle Eastern bizarre bargaining?
There's no resolution. We are not, this proposal does not change the transfer pricing.
I don't think this proposal really cares about resolving cases of competent authority with potential double tax.
This proposal doesn't raise issues of transfer pricing. The transfer pricing is a separate determination that occurs with regard to the companies involved, and this proposal applies with that regard, just like any other subpart F.
I'm sorry, that example, though, really of excess profits really does get you to transfer pricing, and you're going to have that country, that foreign country that's going to prepare its own local documentation and said these returns are at arm's length, and you're going to pull them back under the subpart FX.
I'm sorry.
That's what it says.
No, they're both
actually,
about source.
It doesn't say that. Let me just be clear, because I think given that we've written the proposal, I can tell you how we would implement it. The proposal simply creates a category of subpart F. What that means, and the excess returns calculation is the side calculation that's used to determine what is the category of subpart F. Subpart F, in the context of a worldwide system, is about when you tax income, how much income should be in one subsidiary versus in the parent.
But we have to move on to the debate, I think. Plainly,
I think we are debating.
I know. This is true. You are irreconcilably.
Just one quick line I want to say.
I do agree with
arm's
that.
Length is about source. Or transfer pricing is about source, and this is about source. But that doesn't mean that this is about transfer pricing, because transfer pricing is an extremely imperfect approach to source, even well-executed.
This proposal is too much income in one year in a low-tax jurisdiction.
So we're going to give the audience a chance to weigh in on five debate propositions. These are all in the book. Maybe you could flip the first one up. Next slide. Next one. You know how to use this now? Everybody should look at their little device if they want to vote. Okay, go ahead. So the first polling question is the excess income proposal consistent with the commitment of the US and other OECD countries to arm's length transfer pricing, or does the use of subpart F sidestep this issue? Actually, just what we were talking about.
What we were debating. Yeah.
So though yes, consistent with arm's length principle, no, inconsistent.
By the way, the last time I was in a debate with a poll, we had a before and after, which I was glad about because I was arguing a very unpopular position, so all I had to do was do better rather than worse.
Okay, so everybody going to vote on this now? Put your things in. Well, it turns out
wow, we persuaded 25% of the people to agree
that it is inconsistent with arm's length principles. But had we had the vote earlier in the discussion, it might have been even worse. So, okay, so that's that one.
Fundamental misunderstanding of the
proposal. Can you flip slides?
It's just a way of saying.
Here we go. Okay, so here we get, is the excess income proposal a better way? I want to see how Tom votes on this. Address concerns of the U.S. government than a patent box regime. which is, of course, an alternative in the Camp Bill in a funny way, but it's also something that's been adopted by the UK and the Netherlands and other number of other countries. The subpart F inclusion for any low effective tax rate for an income, Japan, or the subpart F inclusion for all royalties, but only a 15% US tax rate. So there are three alternatives. Do we think that Manal's alternative is better than these other ones? Yes. B, no. Get your votes in.
He said, just mine.
You picked up a vote, but
well, since there are four, four alternatives, we pretty much broke even.
Right, so. That's right. So, if you divide it that way. So, okay, so onward. Okay, if income shifting caused by the migration of intangibles and the transfer pricing regulations are a problem that must be addressed, does the excess income proposal go far enough? In other words, should it go farther? Should it be more stringent? A is yes, B is no.
Yeah, but this question makes an assumption that people like the excess income proposal.
Well, that's perfectly true. They can abstain.
No, that they agree. Actually, you both agree there's a problem.
Well, I don't think
that
the
mark
does.
Tom did.
Not the way the question's written, though.
So it's
okay,
be split.
Well, actually, this is very interesting.
Because people
so
don't understand.
We have almost 50-50. 49% say it goes far enough. 51% say it doesn't go far enough.
We'll work on it.
I think people misunderstood the question, Manal.
Well, they didn't know which way to vote to be against it, so they couldn't.
Right, right.
Thank goodness for that. Well, we did our best to ask. So.
Okay. So then the fourth, and we come to the fifth in a second, and last, is the definition of affected income. Income from a transaction connected with or benefiting from an intangible in the proposed regulation too broad. Now, if you recollect, I think, Tom, you made the point, maybe you did as well, Marc, that you can have a very minor intangible transferred, which together with existing intangibles that are not covered could infect a lot more income than one would expect.
That was the point of the example.
Of the question, yes, exactly. So is that definition too broad? A, yes. B, no. Here we go. Too broad. A wins by 81% to 19. So
picked up six votes.
Okay, then our last polling question is the overall question. I think we could probably predict how this one's coming out, but we're going to ask you anyway.
We want to see if we get more votes.
Yeah, exactly.
I want to ask, is current law a good policy?
Considering various perspectives, which are the perspectives we've laid out, presumably, does the excess returns legislative proposal represent good or bad U.S. tax policy? And, you know, undefined what tax policy is and what's good and what's bad. So purely judgmental, do you think it's good policy? That's A. Bad policy is B. Lee, why aren't you voting? It's good policy, 27%. Bad policy, 73%. So, I hope you won't take this personally, these...
I do think that, I think that the audience is a bit stacked, but that's okay. I think that one thing I should say, because I do think it's an important, because, you know, I know this is fun, but it is an important technical point from the perspective of the government, because there are students in the audience, I want to make sure that they understand the difference between transfer pricing and subpart F. The reason this is not a transfer pricing adjustment is because taxing this income currently does not result in a change of the prices paid or the income attributed to the CFC versus the parent company at all, not for any other purpose in the tax code and not between the jurisdictions, not for purposes of determining your foreign tax credit or calculating your income. That is a critical point. And to the extent that this is viewed as, you know, an expansion, any subpart F income is viewed as somehow because we tax income currently, it is the same as determining that the income therefore didn't belong to the CFC is just wrong. It's not the way subpart F works, and it wasn't intended to be. I know you don't like the fact that we use excess returns as the way to determine the amount of subpart F, but for tax purposes, the way this will be treated is a subpart F income without an adjustment to the allocation of profit between the two entities involved. And that, speaking of competent authorities, is completely anticipated and permitted within the context of OECD rules, principally in Article 7 dealing with business profits, where it acknowledges that countries may choose to tax income of a parent, tax the parent on income earned by the subsidiary, even though that income earned by the subsidiary is attributable to the subsidiary. I just think as a technical point and as a point with respect to what we are actually doing and the way the law works, it's important to make that clear.
And just to quickly respond, from a 30,000-foot technical point of view, I agree with you, but what you're doing is you're going in the back door when you can't get in through the front door. And to say that this is purely source taxation that has nothing to do with transfer pricing, when the whole premise to bringing about this proposal is because you're concerned about transfer pricing, to me belies some belief.
Well, what is the front door, though,
yeah,
in your analogy?
Exactly.
The front door would be using the traditional rules, and you're going through the back door to create subpart of income to obviate the other rules.
Is that the transfer pricing gets the right answer, which I don't think anyone
believes. No, I'm sorry, but I do believe that if transfer pricing in the OECD's approach with arm's length principles is applied in a correct and appropriate way, and is managed in a responsible way by the government, it can get to probably a better result than this kind of artificial proposal. And the fact of the matter is, I mean, just take by example, Brazil recently changed its transfer pricing rules. Why? Because they had a very simplistic approach that had nothing to do with commercial reality, and it wasn't working. Now that country is really doing extremely well, they're starting to see the problems with whether you call it formulary apportionment or a mechanical test, the transfer pricing. The problem with transfer pricing, in my view, is that there's not enough attention paid to facts and circumstances, and we're always trying to get the result squeezed into some set of comparables, which, as a litigator, we used to say it's garbage in and garbage out.
Well, I would say transfer pricing is garbage in, garbage out. I don't want to step on Manal's point, which is that for the students or whatever, that the foreign tax credit limit is not being reduced
affected
by this. But you have a fundamentally ill-defined idea. You have companies that they're in an industry where there are no comparables, and even if there were some arm's-length companies, they're not really comparable because being a multinational, being an integrated company, means it's a different world. You have the fact that there's basically synergy income. Why do multinationals exist? The main theoretical reason is that it's done where that's the where you'll be more profitable that way than the other way than arm's length. Well, where does that synergy profit? Where does that synergy income from being integrated arise? That's impossible to say. You could imagine in a thought experiment, a U.S. company and a foreign company saying, if we'd be more profitable as a linked multinational, where does the extra profit go? And inherently, transfer pricing standard can't solve that. So transfer pricing is really a fundamentally flawed approach. And again, also, this does not, as Manal said, get in the way of
Tom, do you want to weigh in? I mean, as to whether you know, it's a fundamentally flawed policy?
Well, I think that
if
the provision...
So, what is the solution, or if not...
Well, formulary is flawed, too.
The provision is an anti-veritas provision, right? If the IRS were more successful at setting up and winning cases, then I don't think there'd be the incentive to have this. I will say that really valuable intangibles are valuable because of their uniqueness. And so searching for comparables is like searching for a unicorn, right?
Absolutely.
You might know what you're looking for, but you're never going to find it. And, you know, therefore, it needs some solution that is formula-based in some regard, whether it's, you know...
So you don't think it's the IRS's fault, like you're a colleague over here?
Oh, I have great respect for the IRS.
Well, the Congress for underfunding the IRS.
let me make it very clear. I think that, you know, when I started doing transfer pricing, we looked at it as somewhat of an art form. We looked at comparables to help us work, use as a proxy to work with the facts and circumstances to come up with a commercial result. Today, it's all about the comparables, and I have a significant problem when you just focus on comparables where they're not comparables, particularly in many industries and many unique intangibles. But that doesn't necessarily mean that you can't work with the arm's length principle to try to create proxies, you know, for the transfer pricing and try to make it work. I think the problem, frankly, is that the Treasury has created a bear with the complicated rules. And I think the rules, as they've been created, are very difficult to administer. I think that the IRS right now, with their new transfer pricing director, is trying to very much take handle of training and picking out the tough cases and litigating the tough cases, because they haven't won any cases. And the reason they haven't won any cases, they haven't picked up any good cases to really try. So I don't agree with you that the policy and the law is flawed, but I think the way it's been administered over the last number of years, starting with this maniacal result that we created with cost sharing, is created a bear that is unadministrable.
Okay, he had the last word because we've run out of time.
Well, that's a good fact.
And we were thank almost you. Persuaded.
Yeah, thank you very much. It was great.
Thank you, Tom. That was great. Thank you, Willard. Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Marc. That was wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Dan. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Manal. Appreciate it. It was really terrific. You're a great sport.
Is it going to move around if I leave it in my pocket?
Okay. To keep the program moving on to our next segment. First, we want to thank the panel and Manal in particular for being a good sport on that debate. The next segment is going to focus on post-acquisition planning for intangibles. In particular, the discussion will center around tax planning for migration of intangibles of a U.S. target company post-acquisition, both in the context of a U.S. acquirer as well as a foreign acquirer. This discussion is going to be led by Pat Jackman. Pat is a principal in KPMG's Washington National Tax Practice, where he specializes in cross-border international corporate acquisitions, mergers, internal restructurings, business formations, and joint ventures. Pat is a frequent speaker, writer, and is co-author of the leading international M&A tax treatise, U.S. Taxation of International Mergers, Acquisitions, and Joint Ventures. Pat.
Thank you, Larry. Let me just make sure. And you said it was simple. I tested that. So we're going to switch gears just a bit here. No, we're not going to abandon discussing intangibles altogether, but I think we're going to try to broaden the focus a little bit more. As Larry suggested, we're going to talk about acquisitions of a U.S. target And we're going to talk about acquisitions of U.S. targets that have more than intangibles. But the idea is that by looking to the mix of the assets of the U.S. target and the mix of intangibles, U.S. and foreign-owned, it may influence some of the acquisition structures, or that's the idea that we'll see how that influences acquisition structures. Larry did also suggest that this was going to be a discussion of a foreign parent acquirer versus a U.S. parent acquirer. And this is one of those examples when you put the slides together a month before you're going to present, you sometimes change what you want to talk about. And also given the makeup of the audience, I'm going to spend almost all my time with a U.S. multinational focus. And towards the end, we'll talk about a foreign parent with a little bit of compare and contrast to a U.S. acquirer. So what that means, let's see here. Oh, there we go. The good news for those people looking for a break is that we're going to skip a few of these slides. There we go.
That green one.
Right, yeah. There we go. Okay. Next. Okay. Here we are. So, as I said, we're going to discuss some acquisition structures with of a U.S. target, and even more specifically, we're going to focus on what is referred to as foreign funding structures, meaning we're looking at situations where even though we're looking to acquire a U.S. target, we're going to try to access offshore cash of CFCs to make that acquisition. And like I said, once again, the idea is that we'll have the U.S. target have different types of assets and see how that influences either the type of foreign funding structure or the benefits of a particular foreign funding structure. Before I get into the specific structures that are outlined here, it's always useful to compare a more complicated, or at least we'll see that it's a more complicated structure with what might be a baseline transaction. And so, to me, a baseline transaction when you're looking at a U.S. target that has a combination of U.S. Assets and it's got foreign assets is you would probably say, okay, well, if I was ignoring both commercial issues and tax issues, I would like to have a CFC of my U.S. acquirer buy the foreign assets, and I'll have the U.S. acquire the U.S. assets. Well, a couple of issues come to mind why that's probably not what you can do. One is a commercial issue, which is typically if you're acquiring a U.S. target that's certainly a publicly traded U.S. target, then you're not going to have an opportunity, generally speaking, to buy the pieces of the U.S. target. It's kind of a one-swoop transaction where usually pursuant to a merger mechanic, you'll buy out the target shareholders, and it's left to the acquirer to sort out the pieces. So then, okay, so we don't do it as part of the acquisition, we do it post-acquisition. And there's probably two things to focus on in terms of why the baseline transaction is not going to be as good as these foreign funding structures. One issue is the fact that if you're buying stock assets post-acquisition, and again, the idea here is we're trying to tap into cash of our CFCs, if we're buying stock assets, the CFC acquirer is effecting a 304 transaction, and the starting point is that it's hard to access the cash of the CFCs, and that's because simply bringing the cash back to the U.S. would result in significant residual U.S. tax. So that's one issue. Post-acquisition, the baseline doesn't work because of you're running into the problem that you've tried to avoid, which is a dividend out of your CFC acquirer. The second point is, to the extent that some of these transactions have a taxable component to them, you would like to have the tax that you paid generate a favorable tax attribute. You normally think that if you go out and you buy something, you get tax basis. You can utilize that tax basis. Sometimes you go out, you buy an asset, you can amortize the purchase price. The tax attribute that we're going to focus on in these structures is turning the earnings and profits, and that earnings and profits may have resulted from turning unrealized appreciation into earnings and profits. But the point is, you're going to turn earnings and profits into previously taxed income, and previously taxed income will give us an opportunity to reverse the normal ordering rule that earnings come out first and then capital comes out second. So let's, without further ado, next, talk about the first of the structures, which is the outbound de-reorganization. And I gather from the morning session that there was at least a primer on 367 rules, but just to give 2 minutes on the basics. So we know that 367A is focused on a toll charge, gain recognition on an outbound transfer of assets. We've got two exceptions for an active foreign trader business or for stock transfers. And then we've got 367A5, which will be relevant here, which only in the world of 367A do we have an exception to the exception. So if we look at the first part of 367A5, we're back to gain recognition. But even within 367A5, we have another exception that says, in situations where our US target is owned by five or fewer domestic corps, we have an opportunity to make basis adjustments in the stock of the CFC acquirer to preserve the gain that's leaving the US taxing jurisdiction on the assets. So where we are is trying to take advantage of that exception under 367A5. And then last but not least, 367D, which is imputing income on the sort of similar to a contingent sale on intangibles that are going outbound. And this will be relevant for our discussion. It'd be nice to have a polling for this on technical issues as opposed to kind of normative questions, but how you treat foreign goodwill will be important to this particular structure. So just to set up the example, let's assume that US Target is acquired for $100. US Target has a mix of assets. It's got an active foreign trader business. It's got stock in a CFC. It's got a 936 intangible. And there's goodwill, foreign goodwill, or one would think it's foreign goodwill, associated with the active foreign trader business. And so those mix of assets, they're all appreciated, but some have some tax basis. So following the acquisition of US Target, the goal is to do an outbound reorganization where all of US Target's assets are transferred to a CFC acquirer. And what we're trying to solve for, again, coming back to our objective, how can we utilize cash of our CFC? So we're trying to, as part of this post-acquisition transaction, tap into cash of our CFC. But, as I said, to fit within the exception in 367A5, that is going to put a cap on the amount of cash that the CFC can pay out. If we didn't have to worry about international rules, given that the shareholder has a $100 basis in US Target, and the US Target is essentially a conduit for cash, we could have the CFC acquirer pay $100 a boot to the US Target, and that would be distributed to the US parent, and there would be no tax. But we have to layer in, we can't use $100 worth of cash because we have to preserve the inside gain on some of our assets. Would have been better if I'd had the breakout of the particular assets, but assume that the 367A assets, and I'm going to include for the moment foreign goodwill in 367A, assume that the 367A assets, which again are a combination of stock in a CFC, got an active foreign trader business, and I have goodwill associated with that active foreign trader business, they make up $75 worth of the $100 in the US target, and the other $25 is this 936 intangible. So the question is, how do I solve for, and let me give you numbers in terms of the amount of gain inherent in the $75. Assume that the tax basis, aggregating everything, which is how the proposed 367A5 regs work, I'm going to aggregate the basis in all of those assets and assume that that aggregates to $30. So I've got $75 of value, 30, I've got $45 of appreciation that pursuant to this outbound asset reorg looked like they're leaving US taxing jurisdiction. So what the proposed 367A5 regs do, it's kind of two things that they do in terms of how you solve for the amount of cash. One is you've got to match up the amount of stock and cash in respect of the 367A assets, and you match up a portion of the stock and cash that are attributed to the 367D asset. So again, in our situation, 3/4 of the total value were 367A assets. So any stock that's utilized by CFC to acquire the assets, 3/4 of that is going to be attributed to the US target. So in this example, the other thing I need to solve for is I need to have sufficient amount of stock that is attributable to the 367A assets that will allow me to do my basis reduction. Because again, we started the conversation with, in order to be able to fit within a 367A5 exception, the inside gain that I have on my 367A assets needs to be preserved in my stock. So in this example, the maximum amount of cash, I'll back into the cash. The stock that I'm going to need is I'm going to need $45 worth of stock attributable to the 367A assets, and that's because $45 of value will allow me to make a $45 tax basis reduction, and that will preserve the $45 of gain in the assets in the stock. So again, $60 worth of stock, $40 worth of cash, and the answer makes sense, probably a little maybe hard to follow the math, but at the end of the day, when I look at the shareholder of the CFC, the shareholder of the CFC is holding $60 worth of stock because it's got $40 of cash. If there were no basis adjustments, they would hold that $60 worth of stock with a $60 basis, but 367A5 will ensure that the gain is preserved by reducing that basis down to 15, and so 60 minus the 15 preserves the $45 of gain in the stock. Just to highlight, so to run a few different scenarios, I said at the outset that I'm going to treat goodwill as a 367A asset. And there is certainly a debate as to whether goodwill for different purposes is 367A asset or 367D asset. I'm not going to go into sort of the textual and legislative history argument, but you can see that my bias is to say that goodwill is a 367A asset, and that therefore, as part of this, you need to preserve the amount of gain inherent in the goodwill when you're doing your 367A5 adjustments. However, there are definitely good arguments on the other side to treat goodwill as a 367D asset. We've got regulations that tell us that 367D does not apply to foreign goodwill. One might read that regulation as suggesting that absent the reg, It was intended that goodwill would be a 367D asset. I don't happen to buy into that argument, but that's an argument. Another argument is that the IRS has told us that in various directives and elsewhere that goodwill is a 367D asset. Usually they're making that argument when it's favorable to them. If we come back to this, and I will come back to the example, treating goodwill as a 367D asset in this outbound asset reorg will allow additional cash to come back without having to have an imputed 367D amount. And just quickly, just follow, hang with me in terms of the math. The goodwill asset that I dealt with before, all of the four categories that I talked about, just to keep it easy, goodwill, active trader business, stock in a CFC, and the US-owned IP are each worth $25. The foreign goodwill, $25, and one would quite normally presume that the tax basis would be zero in the goodwill. Treating the goodwill as a 367D asset, what that does is because you're no longer forced to preserve the gain in the goodwill because it's subject to a 367D, 367A5 is just all about preserving the inside gain with respect to 367A assets. It figures that 367D assets will be handled just finally with 367D. You don't need to preserve the inherent gain. So anyways, going back to our numbers, the bottom line is that my 367A assets are now half of my total value of US target. But the amount of gain that I need to preserve, previously it was 45. With the goodwill gone, which was a $25 appreciated asset, I'm only needing to preserve 20 of gain, but I need to also take into account that I'm only able to reduce tax basis in stock that's attributed to my 367A assets, half of any stock that's part of the transaction, because half of the value of target is 367A assets, only half of the stock will be attributable to, only half of the stock will be matched up with a 367A asset. So coming back to our situation, backing into the number, I need $40 worth of stock as part of the total consideration. Half of that gets matched up with my 367A assets, so now I've got $20 worth of stock, and that $20 of stock will allow me to preserve the $20 of gain that I have. So if we're comparing and contrasting, treating goodwill, and not surprisingly, the more you move away from 367A assets and more you move to 367D allows you to get more and more cash out in an outbound reorg. But on our particular facts, treating goodwill as a 367A asset has resulted in 40 of cash coming out. If I decide that goodwill is a 367D asset for this purpose, the amount of cash is now moves from 40 to 60, because again, I walked through the example and I needed $40 worth of stock to preserve $20 worth of gain. Just a couple of other points on this particular example. You see here where domestic assets are moving to the US NewCo. And so these could be, we don't have them in my example, but these could be just basic US trader business assets. Or let's assume that the US owned IP, which had $25 worth of value in zero basis, let's assume that rather than subjecting that IP to a 367D regime, I decided that I'd rather have that IP drop back into the US. And there's a coordination rule that there's a bit of, there's logic to calling off 367D when an asset goes outbound, but it comes back inbound, because now your IP is back in US taxing jurisdiction. And so the coordination rule between 367A and D and the indirect stock transfer rules will say as long as that asset's coming back into the US, there won't be subjected to the 367D regime. The price of doing that, there's sort of two consequences of doing that. One is you've now turned the transaction into an indirect stock transfer. And so USP is treated as the US NewCo that's underneath CFC1 is analogized to as if USP had transferred a portion of UST stock to CFC acquirer, because you end up in a similar position. And that indirect stock transfer, meaning USP is treated as, for a proportionate amount, transferring US stock outbound, that's a taxable transaction. There's no exception for transferring US stock in this situation. But assuming that USP is looking at its basis in the stock as opposed to inside basis, USP had full fair market value basis, and there's no cost to the indirect stock transfer rule. So that's one consequence. The other thing to keep in mind is that by moving the intangibles back into U.S. taxing jurisdiction, you now are subjecting the value of the IP to the consequences as if it was a 367A asset. So the point is that now, because the patent that you put back into the U.S. no longer subject to 367D for measuring the amount of cash that you can take out, you measure the amount of cash now having to reflect this appreciation. And so getting back to our facts, where now 100%, this is treating goodwill as a 367A asset, 100% of your assets of U.S. target are now treated as 367A assets. So at the outset, although it's not on the slides, at the outset I said the amount of appreciation in all of your assets was $70. You basically have $30 worth of basis in your stock, and you've got combined with your basis in your active foreign trader business. Now that 100% of my assets are 367A, I need $70 worth of stock to preserve the inside gain. The inside gain is the full $70. So the point of working through the exercise is, one, how you treat goodwill, how much of your US target is composed of IP versus 367A assets is going to impact how much cash you can take out in an outbound reorg. One other thing I'll just note is that one thing that was something that got the dander of the IRS up was transactions that known as sort of deadly deeds, which were not only taking advantage of the basis that USP had in US target stock, because when we were talking about making basis reductions, we were only focused on the $100 that USP had in US target stock. Prior to the IRS issuing a notice and coming out with final regs, taxpayers were taking the position that not only could they reduce basis in their US target stock, if they happened to be an owner of CFC1, like in this case, they could take advantage of basis in CFC1 stock as well. Again, the idea being that you're trying to preserve the inside gain in your stock gain. And so if you're reducing the basis, even if it's historical CFC1 stock, you're still reflecting in your outside stock that appreciation that has left U.S. taxing jurisdiction. That was the theory. Again, it was rejected by the IRS as a technical matter, and then obviously there were some policy concerns. So let me flip to the next slide. So just, we've talked about some of these issues already. One we talked about in terms of the goodwill asset, in terms of whether it's 367A or 367D. The first bullet point is turning our attention to the 367D asset. So we talked about how if the US-owned IP, in my case, the patent, if that patent were just transferred to the CFC acquirer as part of the outbound reorg and not dropped down to US NewCo, that's subject to 367D. I also mentioned that in terms of matching up the consideration that was paid out by CFC acquirer, the approach is to allocate a certain amount of cash and stock to the 367D asset, and a certain amount of the cash and stock is matched up against the 367A assets. So the question is, obviously, if you've got mixed consideration, you're going to have some amount of the cash be allocable to the 367D asset. And the question is whether the cash consideration that's paid in respect to the 367D asset, whether that can be treated as a prepayment of sort of the deemed royalty that would exist under 367D. And again, there's probably good arguments going both ways, but at least my own personal view is the better view is that the consideration that is passing through the US target is passing through more as a sort of a conduit, and it's coming back to the US shareholder, and it's not, 367D is not taking the outbound IP transfer completely out of the normal 361 treatment, and therefore the cash is really funneling to the shareholder. It's not in any way a prepayment of the royalty. Definitely there are folks that will disagree with that, and they're good arguments. One more point, and we'll move on to the other structures. To the extent that assets are being dropped down to the new US company, and we'll see this in our other structures, first thing that goes off is, CFC, you told me it had low tax DMP and they couldn't repatriate. That looks like an investment in US property. On our particular facts, where what's being pushed down is IP without any tax basis, you don't worry about the fact that they're holding US stock. That's zero basis property. But to the extent that as a way to avoid the toll charge on US assets other than IP, to the extent that you're trying to avoid the toll charge by dropping those into US NewCo, you do have an issue on a go-forward basis that the cost of not picking up gain on the outbound transfer is that you now have an investment in US property equal to the tax basis of that property. Okay, the next structure is probably a little bit more analogous to, let's think about buying the pieces of the target company. It's not in form buying the pieces, but at the end of the day, the goal is that the foreign operations of the US target end up underneath CFC acquirer, and the US operations end up under the US group. One other difference, and this will also apply for the third structure, one other difference between this and the first structure is this is intended to be partly taxable. You ultimately are going to pay tax on the appreciation in your the foreign operations that you get out from under the US. And so then it's back to, are you incurring tax and creating a favorable tax attribute? And we'll see that you are, in fact, doing that. It's probably a reasonable question, what the heck does this have to do with IP? At least the prior one had a bunch of technical issues in terms of if you have a US target with lots of intangible value and very little 367A value, you increase the amount of cash in your outbound reorg. This transaction is, the relevance of the IP is it really goes to if the IP is foreign owned, so that there's been some sort of restructuring of the US target to move IP out from the US, out from under the US previously, then that will, in terms of a sizing point, will allow your CFC acquirer to use more of its cash to buy foreign assets. So that's kind of the overview. Let's just walk through the steps. So the idea here is that U.S. Target is worth $500, and it's, just to keep it easy, its sole foreign operations are in a CFC that's worth $270, or $270 million if we want it to be. So with a $500 acquisition price, and we've got foreign assets worth $270, the idea is that how you form your acquisition vehicle and how you hold, at least temporarily, your U.S. target is going to be based on the relative values of foreign versus U.S. And so you're going to utilize your CFC to fund, M sub is just a merger co to facilitate the acquisition of the U.S. target, but CFC will utilize $270 million of its cash to fund merger sub, and your U.S. is funding merger sub with $230 of value, which may be cash, it may be stock, it depends on what the ultimate deal is in terms of what the target shareholders are getting. The point is that you're utilizing the CFC's cash to fund the acquisition. And so here's what it looks like after the acquisition is complete. You've got CFC 1 holding its proportionate share of U.S. target, the $270 million of value. You have your U.S. parent, or it could be a sub of U.S. parent, holding 46% in this example, $230 million of value that's reflecting the value of the U.S. operations. Well, that looks like a pretty ugly structure, and not surprisingly, in any of these structures where you're trying to utilize CFC cash, you're stuck, generally speaking, with finessing 956 issues, which makes sense because you're using a CFC to acquire U.S. property. So we stop here for a second, but we know that we're not going to want CFC 1 to continue to hold stock in a U.S. company. Actually, if I just go. So then the transaction is, well, how do I split up U.S. target and give U.S. target the CFC assets or the stock of the CFC and move the U.S. operations up to the U.S. parent? Because again, that's what I'm looking to do. I'm looking to have my CFC own the foreign stuff and the U.S. own the U.S. stuff. The mechanic for doing that is, because I'm thinking about sort of two characteristics. I don't want CFC 1, which is the funding party, ultimately acquiring the CFC's operations. I don't want that acquisition of the stock of the CFC to be a 304 transaction. Again, I don't want a dividend from the CFC 1. Likewise, if I'm going to pay tax on the transaction, I'd like that to create a favorable tax attribute that I can use down the road. So in terms of the steps, U.S. target would be acquired by U.S. parent in an upstream A merger. So that's how the U.S. assets make their way to USP. As part of that same transaction, CFC1, which is a shareholder in UST, CFC1, as part of a reorg, is receiving the stock of TCFC, which is going to be booted in the reorg, even though it's coming from the target company, and also they're going to get stock in the U.S. parent. And so what has happened as part of this upstream merger transaction is that, like I said, the U.S. stuff has now, in the U.S. group, your TCFC stock is now underneath CFC1. The cost of moving TCFC to CFC1 was, again, it was boot in a reorganization, so whatever gain there was inherent in the stock of TCFC1, That gain is triggered, and then the question is, so US, remember UST was the owner of stock of TCFC. The gain in the stock of TCFC is triggered, and then the question is, how much of that gain gets recharacterized under 1248? And like in most situations, recharacterizing that gain as 1248 is advantageous. You're from a sourcing and accessing foreign tax credits. You want the gain to be recharacterized under 1248. And on a go-forward basis, to the extent that the gain is recharacterized as a 1248 dividend, that value that's still sitting in TCFC, because it's a construct, all of those earnings and profits that you were taxed on, or UST was taxed on, have now been turned into previously taxed income. So I didn't put forth how much gain there was in the stock of TCFC, but let's say that we said 270 of value, and there's a little rounding going on here because I haven't accounted for the value of the USP stock that needs to go to CFC1. In fact, it's an important point that CFC1 does hold USP stock following this transaction. Once again, you got a 956 issue to worry about. But in terms of the gain on the CFC, TCFC, that gain will be taxed to the US target, at least in the situations where one has looked at whether the upstream merger is an effective utilization of trapped cash as part of an acquisition. It really depends oftentimes on whether the US target has favorable tax attributes that can offset that gain that's incurred. So just to round out the discussion, in terms of the final structure, which is referred to as the full foreign acquisition, and again, if we're trying to compare and contrast with the prior alternatives, here, at least in form, just to describe the transaction, CFC is purchasing 100% of US target. So we should have kept the facts comparable, but let's assume we're back to the sort of the first scenario where US target's worth 100. So the CFC is going to be able to utilize 100 of its cash and buy US target. So before I start getting into 956 issues, that seems like a favorably compares to the prior transactions because one, I've actually used 100% cash of the CFC. All $100 is coming from the CFC. But the downside is that my CFC is holding an investment in U.S. property. Here, we know that investment in U.S. property does have $100 worth of basis. So the question is there anything that I can do to deal with the 956 problem? So just on the first alternative, we had to give a very brief primer on 367A and A5. Here, where what's contemplated is that US Target is doing a liquidation, just a quick primer on how 367E2 operates. So 367E2 has kind of a different approach in terms of what exceptions apply to gain recognition. 367A says we're okay with outbound transfers of assets if those assets are part of an active foreign trader business. To the extent that they're part of a US trader business, there's a toll charge. 367E kind of works the reverse and says, well, to the extent that your outbound liquidation, and this is probably a little unusual in terms of the typical outbound liquidation because it's not liquidating into a foreign parent. It's still subject to the subpart F rules. But 367E says we're not going to impose gain recognition to the extent that you continue to have your CFC in this case, which is the recipient of those assets, as long as they're continuing to conduct a U.S. trade or business for a sufficient period of time, that the thought is that those assets are still subject to U.S. taxing jurisdiction and there's no reason to have a toll charge. In addition, to the extent that you're distributing stock of a U.S. company, same basic idea, those assets are still subject to U.S. taxing jurisdiction. On the foreign side, to the extent that you're doing a liquidation and those foreign assets are leaving U.S. taxing jurisdiction, there is no exception similar to what exists under 367A. There's an immediate gain recognition. And the one, and here we come back to how intangibles may be relevant to some of this planning, the one exception to transferring assets and having them, this is a U.S. trade or business exception, the one exception to that rule providing for no gain recognition is with respect to intangibles. IRS has basically said, look, we'll give you an exception to the extent that you're conducting a U.S. trade or business, but probably some of the issues that have been discussed previously, but we're concerned when it's intangibles that are going outbound. And so even if those intangibles are part of a U.S. trade or business, we're not going to allow those intangibles to avoid gain recognition. So coming back to our particular situation with that primer, the idea is, which is a bit counterintuitive, that I need to have the CFC eliminate the tax basis in U.S. target, because it's that tax basis that's causing the 956 issue. So the idea is U.S. target liquidates, the $100 worth of basis goes away. U.S. target, now CFC is holding stock of a U.S. sub. We're going to have to come back and figure out what the tax basis in the U.S. sub. But presumably, at least on some situations, the U.S. sub has it's grown in value, but that growth in value is attributable to either realized appreciation or unrealized appreciation. It's not because of capital that was put into the U.S. sub, and the idea is that the tax basis is relatively small. As for the distribution of F sub as part of the liquidating distribution, there is tax on the distribution, as I said, under 367E2, and there's gain recognition, sort of similar to our, at least in result, similar to what was happening in the upstream merger transaction, and that is there's gain recognition with respect to the appreciation in F sub, but to the extent that that appreciation is reflected as a 1248 dividend, it may be something that one can live with based on whether U.S. target has tax attributes that can be used to offset whatever that tax is. And then again, the idea is that on a go-forward basis, you now have F sub underneath the CFC, and F sub, to the extent that they did have gain that was recharacterized as 1248, would have previously taxed income that would allow a cash repatriation at a later date. The one thing that was on a prior slide is if UST has intangibles, just said that 367E, even if those intangibles are used in a U.S. trade or business, those intangibles are not, they're not accepted from the gain recognition rule. They don't fit within the U.S. trade or business exception, so that it might be desirable to contribute those intangibles to the U.S. sub prior to liquidating U.S. target, because the exception under 367E2 is sort of a subject to meeting the requirements, is a blanket exception for stock of a U.S. sub as opposed to conducting a U.S. trade or business. So this is where we sit at the end of the day. One thing that I'm not going to go into too much detail is that still, in all of these structures, if you were drawing them up, and if it but for trying to tap into CFC cash, they're not structures that one would normally recommend. They look ugly. They're difficult to effect. Oftentimes, there's a certain amount of gain recognition. But again, it's you're living with, you're willing to make compromises to access that CFC cash. Here, one of those compromises, aside from the 956 issue that you have to worry about, is you now have your U.S. company, which is owned by a CFC, not being part of the bigger U.S. consolidated group. And so there may be a transaction that would have the U.S. parent contribute something of value to U.S. sub, so that U.S. sub, even though it's still owned by CFC1, it's owned either at a sufficiently low value amount, or one uses a combination of common and 1504A4 preferred, something that's done so that USS can be consolidated with the U.S. parent. We have a break. So the point of trying to work through these examples, and obviously it's sort of a quick run through, the point is that there are structures that do allow accessing CFC cash to acquire a U.S. target. I mean, it should be, we obviously wouldn't be having a conversation if we were looking at a foreign target. That would be a no-brainer. But there are, you know, fairly complicated and sometimes pretty clumsy structures for acquiring U.S. targets utilizing CFC cash. And those decisions will depend, at least in part, on the makeup of the U.S. target, including its mix of intangibles and how those intangibles are owned. So I think we've got a break.